So here we are, the second part of the journey. We've just seen Peter Molyneux leave Bullfrog to set up another studio in Guildford, Lionhead. His reputation is still akin to a sun god. He'd led one of gaming's greatest studios, responsible for classic after classic. The story of Bullfrog encompasses not just Molyneux, but a whole generation of great British coders who got started there. The man is by this point already a legendary figure. Only a couple of game designers could ever have claimed to surpass the reputation that Peter Molyneux had back in 1997. We didn't know what Lionhead was going to do, but we were pretty sure it was going to be great. And so this is the first part of their story. The attempt to create a new, truly independent studio, even as gaming itself got bigger and bigger. We'll go up all the way to the creation of a monster that ended up swallowing it whole. But for now, it's time to, once again, play God. In many ways, the formation of Lionhead Studios was Peter Molyneux starting from scratch. He'd tired of the situation at Bullfrog, and now it was time to re-roll.
This time, all the problems that we've had in the past we can get right. We have got to create some great original ideas, some ideas that have never been attempted or created before.
He'd do so with the aim to avoid what he'd had near the end of his time there. He didn't want to employ lots of people, and he wanted to be free of control from any big publisher so that he could focus entirely on game design. Essentially just as Bullfrog were in the days before they were bought by Electronic Arts. He stated his two cardinal rules many times, including here in a 1997 interview with Simon Carless. Lionhead will only work on one title at a time, and they would never employ more than 20 people. Molyneux wanted a small team comprised of what he naturally dubbed the best of the best of the best, whether it was people he'd previously worked with at Bullfrog, or a scant few who were recruited through adverts in the likes of Edge magazine.
Peter founded Lionhead with the intention of keeping that family atmosphere, keeping teams together and passionate about their projects, not big company politics and being part of a machine.
It was a test. In a time when studios were vastly expanding to meet the increased requirements of the generation's standards, was there still space for a small studio? Peter Molyneux would break both of those walls eventually, but we'll see how long he lasted.
We originally wanted to call Lionhead Red Eye. It turned out that Red Eye, just about every company in the world is called Red Eye, and we couldn't call it Red Eye, so we panicked. Mark Webberly, my business partner, says, "Hey, why don't we call it after my hamster? He's called Lionhead." Mark then went to go and check on the hamster. He turned out to be dead, in his cage, stiff with rigor mortis. So we are named after a dead hamster.
The other main reason for Lionhead was so that Molyneux could create, well, his next grand vision. Something groundbreaking that would take a very long time and would not have been possible at Bullfrog. It's thought that by the time of this interview, he and Demi Hassabi were around a year into creating what would eventually be Black and White. The game isn't even called that yet, but Molyneux simply says that the new project is simply far beyond anything that they've attempted before and doesn't even tie his mast to a rough release date. It would soon be too big for the cellar of his mansion. Lionhead quickly moved into new offices in Guildford, at 1 Ockham Court, a decently sized space with essentially a decent pub close by. The boys' club atmosphere reigned once again, with the staff working from morning till midnight on the game, fueled by endless cigarettes and Chinese takeaways. The familiar rules were still in place. Stop everything on Friday afternoon for a creative meeting, and test, test, test. As soon as a working prototype was playable, Molyneux felt it imperative to test as much as possible. Not just to spot bugs and problems, but to see where the game could go next. The Molyneux philosophy then is just as it was with Populous. A game isn't planned meticulously from the outset, so much as it is evolved into being, usually through lots of testing and brainstorming. Again, people who worked at Lionhead attest that this wasn't due to Molyneux having a whip hand. He didn't have one. He didn't even specify hours for employees. Seemingly you just went there, and that was where you were for however long. Molyneux inspired creativity and he inspired dedication. The early days of Lionhead were just as fertile as the glory days of Bullfrog, only now all of the energy was focused on one title that was, apparently, monumental. Scheduling was not a thing, the game would be done when it was done, but it had to be done. In the later days of development, there was a period where the team spent 9 months working 15 hours a day in the studio in typical crunch fashion. Even though some folks bowed out, such as Demi Hassabi in 1998, the 25-strong studio was filled with people who had become amongst the best and brightest in British gaming, just as Bullfrog was. I mean, as damaging as it could have been to lose a literal genius who knows more about AI than just about anyone in the world, the other man who was actually hired thanks to that Amiga Power competition in 1992 as a runner-up, and would later go on to sell his company DeepMind to Google for $500 million, Lionhead was strong enough to weather that particular blow.
Even can predict ahead of time, it's modelled the world, the game world so well, it knows where the Space Invaders will be ahead of time. So as the Space Invaders speed up, when you get less of them on the screen, it fires the final shot as a kind of predictive shot of where the final Space Invader will be in a few seconds' time.
The new team was stocked full of talent. There were names like Mark Webley, Mark Healy and Jonty Barnes who had been with Molyneux since the Bullfrog days, as had Andy Wobson, who headed up the all-important testing department and had the power to say to Molyneux that this idea was unworkable, or sod this other idea, there's bugs that need fixing. And he did so, often. Paul McLaughlin and Russell Shaw, heading up art design and music respectively, had been with Molyneux virtually since the start. Newer hires, such as Kareem Atuni, would go on to achieve greatness later on, having started out with Lionhead. It was a team that could undoubtedly match the quality of Bullfrog's, if not surpass it. Which is one of the reasons why Lionhead never achieving their full potential was such a great shame. But of course we have to get into that later, much later. One thing is for sure, in the utterly convoluted and incestuous world of the British games industry, you can find a quite ridiculous amount of people connected to Molyneux, or who got their start from Molyneux. Anyway, back to Black and White. Every so often, the hype for the game would rise as Molyneux came back to the press, a surefire way to earn column inches and TV time. Here's Lionhead in December 1999, with Molyneux showing off early bits of the gameplay.
Here, there is a barrel. And on that barrel is a little apple. And in that apple, you can just see there is a worm. And I can go from looking at this worm and pull back and actually look at the whole village, obviously, and even go further back and look at the whole world.
Here's Molly again on the final ever episode of Bits, talking up the game with Emily Newton-Dunn and saying some quite questionable things.
There's lots of special things you can do with a creature. First of all, on his first birthday, he will have this overwhelming urge to create his own web page. Another thing you can do that's great with the creature is tattoo him.
It is probably around here, now that Molyneux is on camera more and more, where we really see Molyneux's media personality come to the fore. But we'll go through that soon enough. For now, Molyneux was content with usually saying relatively modest things. For the most part, at least at this moment, features that Molyneux talk about end up in the finished game. Although it is obviously going to be utterly groundbreaking.
Me as a games designer didn't say, right, you will be evil, or you will be good, or you have to do this, or you have to do that to actually progress through the game. You'd be yourself. Then this fascinating thing could happen, is the game would actually perhaps turn into something like a personality test. So there was lots of sort of complicated ideas bobbing around in my head, as there normally is, I suppose.
Meanwhile, the work continued furiously as EA, the game's publisher, constantly asked questions about the game's development that could be summed up as simply, when the hell is this coming out? As the cycle got longer and longer, and the game got more and more out there. And naturally, expensive. Not that Lionhead tended to believe all that much in deadlines. The hype was probably right on the brink of being too much, and too long at this point. Black and White was going to be the greatest PC game ever, but when were we actually going to see it? And geez, what about the ports? They were supposed to be a thing that came out for people to buy, and something to really show that the consoles could handle a god game of this magnitude. This is the trailer for the PS1 version. And here's another trailer for the Dreamcast version. Neither version is available, but both were apparently quite close to completion around the time that the hammer fell on them. However, these ports never arrived. In particular, the Dreamcast being discontinued in April of 2001 was a fatal blow to the port's developers, Chrysalis Software, who also happened to be Amiga veterans, by the way. Finally, and most brutally, EA were not interested in hiring the development team and saving the games. And indeed, the studio. The cancellation of the black and white ports killed Chrysalis and lay folded in November of 2001. Just one minor casualty of this whole production cycle. Finally though, after all the drama of building a new 30-person studio, the arrivals and departures, the genesis, all of that coding, the endless testing and a shipping container's worth of chicken chow mein, at the start of 2001, Black and White arrived, one of the most hyped PC games ever. But before the reaction, let's see what it's like to actually play Black and White in 2016. Oh, wait, no. There's something else I need to digress into quickly.
Well, if it isn't Tamagotchi, her new favorite pet.
Yes!
So what's that make me? Fish sticks?
Oh, are you hungry?
Oh, no. By all means, feed it. Play till your heart's content.
Tamagotchis. The spawn of two people, Akihiro Yokoi and Akimaita. Originally sold by Bandai in late 1996, and it didn't take long for them to become massive worldwide with millions upon millions sold. They were virtual pets that you could play with via a little LCD screen, and you could wear the Tamagotchi around your neck. You could feed it, nurture it, all sorts. You could create your own little virtual pet family. The Tamagotchi craze hit over here in 1997, and basically everybody had one. Well, every girl anyway. The Tamagotchi was marketed as quite a feminine toy over here. The more masculine and extreme version was also sold in 1997, the original Digimon. The toys could be controversial, as half a day of not caring for the pet could be disastrous and result in their death, meaning that kids took their Tamagotchis to school. You know how annoying 30-year-old farts who you went to school with on Facebook always post silly pictures about how they weren't distracted by their mobile phones in class? Yeah, right. They had Tamagotchis to distract them instead. Anyway, you'll never guess who else had a Tamagotchi. Yep. Peter Molyneux loved his Tamagotchi, fed his Tamagotchi, cared for his Tamagotchi, talked about his Tamagotchi to everyone. Including Andy Robson, who frankly didn't see the appeal of the thing. One day, when Molyneux was out of the office, Robson took Peter Molyneux's Tamagotchi and dropped it into a mug of hot tea. Upon his return, Molyneux was horrified to find the scene of the crime, the murder of his beloved Tamagotchi. According to some, he mourned. And perhaps it was this moment, this realisation of just what feelings you could have for an entirely virtual pet, that set Molly's world afire even more than those isometric blocks that had triggered Populous. This virtual pet ended up truly defining just what sort of a game Black and White was going to be. Black and White is indeed the sort of god game where you can do anything and be anything. In many ways, it's the classic video game fake morality where, apparently, choosing whether or not you want to throw a villager directly into the sun with that big old hand for no reason is a deep moral decision worthy of a 9.5 from GameSpot. And yet, there is also a sort of real morality in how you treat the pull of the game, the virtual creature. The creature is supposed to be a representation of you on Earth, and you can train it to do anything. It can eat grass, animals, and yes, people. That's also more sandbox shenanigans, but the morality comes in what you do next. Stroke the creature, or slap it. You get to tell the creature if what it did was good or bad. There's very few games where you are so utterly in control of the rules as you are in Black and White, where your actions can have such an effect on a creature's personality. The way that you treat your creature, and your people, affects the very nature of your world, and both approaches have advantages. You have to make people believe, and you can do that through performing miracles and saving their lives, or aiming a few boulders at their houses. That creature, as they grow bigger in size, becomes the main defender of your land, and they can fight others. The world itself will appear different depending on just what you do. It's all quite muddy, as there's no right way to achieve your goal as a god. It becomes an almost impulsive and barely thought through decision, reacting to things as they happen. Black and White is kind of an odd title, to be honest. It doesn't actually fit with just how grey the game can be. A creature picks up a person, toys around with it a bit, and you give it a stroke for just being so nice. Then after you've done that, the creature eats the person to the horror of everyone. On one level, this will never stop being really frickin' funny, but it sticks with you as you actually ponder why that happened. Maybe the creature wasn't being malicious. Maybe they were just hungry. My creature also ended up eating a beach ball at one point, so maybe I've just built them up to eat everything. Perhaps I should think about changing their diet lest they grow too fat. But is it good, I hear you cry, after all this time yammering on about Tamagotchis and what have you? Yes, it is. It's amazing. Those 5 years were worth it. And it's still amazing because no game has come close to doing what it did before or since. For all the freedom you have, the decision to be a good god and treasure the people, or to rule them with an iron fist, the true freedom is in just watching and letting things happen. Watching as your creature roams free, doing things that make you laugh or even outright shock you. It's still so different, such a wonderfully impulsive experience. And yes, you should still play it now. For me, this game is an essential document. In later years, morality and behaviour and all those things were streamlined with slider bars. How easy? How binary? How boring? Black and White is a dilapidated signpost signalling the hard road not taken. It's not wholly perfect as a game. Some would even say that there isn't even all that much game in here. But for some, just the experience can be unforgettable. Even now, it's the perfect Tamagotchi. The original reception for Black and White was, well, pretty damn great. Huge scores everywhere, big reviews saying that after almost 5 years in development, Lionhead had actually broken new ground. Molyneux was again at the height of his powers. He'd done it again, he'd changed the whole scenery. Weirdly though, that critical love, it didn't last. The backlash against Black and White seemed to start a couple of years later, when GameSpy of all websites put it at the top of a most overrated games list, saying that despite all the creature training, the learning, the freedom, the actual proper frickin' world, where's the game, dude? It's smoke and mirrors, innit? Now, 9.9 times out of 10 people don't listen to GameSpy, but oddly enough, this seemed to stick and the game's reputation just slid from there. I'm not sure if it's harsh or not to say that Black and White is the be here now of Molyneux's career, but for such a praised and big-selling game, it's almost forgotten now. It's an odd middle child between his last projects at Bullfrog, your Dungeon Keepers and the like, and the monster that was to come next and sweep everything away. A sequel, arriving in 2005, was received okay but much more coolly than the original game was, and sales were disappointing. Of course, by that point, Lionhead's mind was on some other game entirely. The game that would dominate everything. But before we get to the monster, I feel that it's only fair to give Lionhead's other original game the time it deserves, because otherwise it's just not going to happen. In 2005, Lionhead released the movies. Adrian Moore headed up the project, a guy who'd gradually worked his way up the Bullfrog ladder before leaving in the late 90s to help start up Small Rockets, another Guildford studio that spun off from the company following Molyneux's departure. Some of those studios didn't make it too far. With Small Rockets gone, along with the likes of Mucky Foot, people like Moore and Gary Carr, of Theme Hospital fame, found themselves hooking up with Molyneux once again at Lionhead, where they would be welcomed with open arms.
So I went back to Peter again. He's like my, you know, my sugar daddy.
Carr would find himself on a quite mysterious project that we can't really go into yet, but Moore would do the movies, a business simulation game. Two words that almost automatically make the game seem like a welcome throwback to the Bullfrog days and games like Theme Park.
You get to build a movie studio. Sounds okay.
You've been working on this game for quite a long time. How long actually has it been in the making?
This, I woke up at 5 o'clock in the morning on January the 19th, 2002, next to my girlfriend. Wow. And I said, I've had this brilliant idea for a game. And she said, Go back to sleep, you crazy idiot.
The premise itself is quite fun. You can be a proper movie mogul. You set up a studio in 1920, hire stars, get scripts written, shoot the films and release them in all their glory, trying to make your studio the best as the eras go by and movies continue to evolve. You react to reviews, hire new stars, manage those stars and make sure they don't claw each other's eyes out, all sorts. It sounds fantastic, but sadly the movies doesn't really do it for me in the way that Bullfrog Sims did. It just lacks something. It never helps when there's an awful and really long tutorial section to kick everything off, of course, but it's the sort of game where it feels like you've seen most of it right out of the gates, like an hour or so in. Make a movie, and repeat. The more movies you make, the better they'll be, and the better your stars will be. It's all about increasing in size. You just don't feel as involved with the process as you did in Theme Hospital and the like. It's almost as if you're a god, not a mogul, funnily enough. The people on the ground are amusing to watch with all their movements and the like and all of their personalities and quirks, but it does all feel a little bit like a fancy take on The Sims, only with a lot of stuff attached that doesn't really fit, meaning of course that it's not as streamlined or as flat out good as The Sims. So yeah, the game starts off quite badly, but a couple of hours in, it turns out it actually does work. You get into a definite rhythm of always doing something. Just as you get in another film ready to shoot, someone's going to be writing the script for the next one. Improvements to the studio come thick and fast, actors are throwing tantrums so you have to try and de-stress them. The unbearably slow and hand-holdy start of the game ends up revealing something quite fast-paced and fun, with definite progression. It's an absolute no-brainer that your first movies will tank horribly, but it gives you time to experiment and get a feel for the whole thing. In the end, it's good. I still don't think it's a patch on either of the proper Theme games, but it has its merits. Even if 1920s cinema audiences might not be quite ready for something like War Men, I can damn well give it to them anyways. Mind you, The Sims side is only one part of the movies. The other part is in actually being able to create your own scenes and the like, which is the way you can actually make these movies feel as if they're your own. This could have been the real pull of the game, and Lionhead definitely knew that. They set up a website where you could upload your movies for the whole world to see. It sounds like a brilliant idea, and it was. Unfortunately, it came just a bit too early. The game itself wasn't a big success. PC gaming wasn't in a good way then, and perhaps the premise was just that little bit too niche. And because of that, the site didn't catch on either. Transplant the movies into 2007, and well, where do you think all those videos of people making their own movies would have ended up? The movies, alas, just missed out on taking advantage of a video sharing website that would have ended up being used by everybody. Maybe that would have sold the game. But alas, the game was a misfire that disappointed for both Lionhead and Activision. It wasn't the only one. 2005's Black and White 2, as previously mentioned, was also a disappointment. Perhaps it added a bit too much and changed a bit too much about something that was already a really good thing. Perhaps there was too much responding to the eventual criticism of Black and White that it just wasn't enough of a game, and in trying to make it more of a game, they kind of took away what was special about it. And well, the shine was already off the original anyway by this point.
The first thing is, you know, just to have some awesome technology And to, you know, put that into a strong gameplay game. And that was the problem with Black and White 1. It's some awesome technology, but where was the game there? And we really wanted to put the game in, so...
And that is the Molyneux cycle. Tell us the next game is going to be amazing, while the last game was rubbish.
Sales for the sequel were once again just below expectations, and that signalled the end of Lionhead and indeed Peter Molyneux's long relationship with Electronic Arts. Such expensive flops take their toll, and Lionhead were at this point starting to flounder behind the scenes. In public though, they were triumphant, having released the first chapter of their biggest series. The thing that Molyneux would describe as the best game ever, the absolute killer app for Microsoft's Xbox, they were firmly in the grip of the monster. Fable was originally known as Project Ego, and was at first the product of a Lionhead satellite studio, one of a few that Molyneux set up agreements with in the early 2000s. Big Blue Box Games, a studio that started out in 1997 in the wake of Molyneux's departure from Bullfrog, and was filled with Bullfrog alumni, in particular Simon and Dean Carter, the original creators of Project Ego. They had their own young guns too, like John McCormack, who had gone to become a big part of Lionhead in the years to come. The aim was an open-ended, open-world RPG where you could be whoever you wanted to be, pretty much. An RPG that was all about your character. It might be surprising to some, considering just how often Molyneux would hype the game up to ridiculous degrees, that the genesis of Fable actually didn't lie with Molyneux. But he certainly embraced the idea quickly, and Fable would become their next big ace in the hole. Molyneux gave Big Blue Box the green light to keep on working, to take that original premise, to ride it into the sun and sell it to publishers, which they did. The satellite studio idea at first seemed innocuous. As we will see, it was the start of Lionhead changing forever. Ultimately, Big Blue Box found a publisher in Microsoft, who felt that Fable might just be the RPG that the Xbox needed. In fact, they absolutely loved everything about it. Fable was, for Microsoft, a potential major player. And once again, in the early 2000s, the hype train started to trundle as Molyneux, at least in public, took the game by the reins.
It's taken a while, and you know, Fable has been in the making now for 4 years, and we're only just confident enough now to start showing it off.
Yeah.
You know, you could be down in the bottom of a town, and one of the town's folks says, oh, can you rescue the girl on top of the cliff? You look up there and there's Eric the Blood Slayer going up the rescue. You think, oh no, he's going to get all the credit for that.
And Lionhead, well, it just grew bigger and bigger. At the time of Black and White, the studio was at around about 30 or so people, and that number would soon treble after it. It also made sense eventually to buy Big Blue Box outright so that the 30-man team would actually have a fighting chance of completing Fable. They now joined forces with Lionhead. There was another Lionhead satellite in the winds, Intrepid, who were working on a game called BC.
BC, you have a tribe, you know, you want to have the tribe grow, which is by getting them food, shelter, you know, all the kind of classic Neanderthal things you need to do to live.
Add it all up, and there's around 150 or so people working for the company, perhaps closer to 200. And yes, they're working on more than one game. In 2002, you had Big Blue Box on Fable, Intrepid on BC, a team on something called Dimitri, and teams for both Black and White 2 and the movies. Later on, it was also announced that Jeff Minter and Llamasoft were working with Lionhead to develop a typically Minter-esque psychedelic sort of game called Unity. Remember that Molyneux had promised that Lionhead would never work on more than one game? Or that there would never be more than 20 people working there? Molyneux's promises, at the start of Lionhead, as honourable as they might have been, simply never had a chance of being fulfilled. In these days and times, working with such big publishers on such big games, it was impossible. It seemed as though Fable also at various points didn't have a chance. The reason why I refer to it as a monster is not because I wish to bag on it, it's because it almost grew unmanageable, beyond anyone's control. Because remember, games evolve here. That's always been the philosophy. But it's almost as if no one realised just how big the game was actually going to become. They underestimated just how much would have to go into a game like Fable. With the best will in the world, the 30-strong team at Big Blue Box would have never had a hope in hell of completing it. But joining forces with Lionhead caused problems of its own, as people who wanted to make a more simulation-style, traditionally Lionhead game balked at the idea of creating an RPG. This didn't describe everybody, but it still caused the odd bit of friction. And of course, there were more casualties, chief amongst them being BC. There just wasn't enough resources to dedicate to this Dawn of Mantastic tribal evolution strategy game, something that was very Lionhead indeed, and it was finally cancelled in late 2004 or so, maybe before. Its demise meant that the satellite studio behind it, Intrepid, also bit the dust. Project Dimitri, something we'll eventually get to, also found itself cancelled, not for the first time, and not for the last time. Unity, the Jeff Minter project, also ended up out of this dimension and out of existence. And the games that we did see? Black and White 2 and the movies both, if anything, suffered from a lack of focus thanks to Fable. It was almost seen as a blessing at points by the teams if Peter's focus wasn't on either game, but they were both somewhat disorganised in development. It was all about the monster, and it needed to feed. If you feel that those games suffered, chances are Fable was the reason why. And of course, in the end, there is the publisher who just wants a game. Fable had been hyped for years now, and you can only call it the best game ever so much before finally, people just want a fucking game. Lionhead, the company that didn't believe in deadlines, would find themselves with a concrete deadline for Gold Masters from Microsoft that must be met or the project is over. And while a lot had been achieved on Fable, from combat to modelling and plenty of tricks, it was still not exactly a game yet at this point.
If you press it, you can go, shit. So when we're playing cooperative, quite often we walk down as a band and go, shit, motherfucker, shit. And we're sort of rapid doing our own rap.
The final year of Fable's development may well go down as the most punishing and brutal death crunch in the history of the whole video game industry, as the ailing Big Blue Box, Lionhead and Microsoft worked together to basically do the tech equivalent of pushing a big steamship up an even bigger frickin' hill. It's up to you whether or not you wish to picture Molyneux as Fitzcarraldo. Creative meetings? Annual leave? Time away from the studio? These things did not happen. There was nothing but the crunch, the act of trying to tame this monster into something of a game, 18 hours a day, every day, for a whole year. Some didn't make it. A lot of people were spent mentally, physically, and spiritually. The crunch is a controversial subject in this business, and for the biggest piece of evidence for the case against, look no further than Fable and what it did to the people who worked on it. The crunch made a Sports Direct warehouse look like a vape shop in Shoreditch. In the end, Fable made it, but the damage was done. Big Blue Box was essentially no more. A 30-person studio that swelled to around 70 during Fable's crunch, it basically burst, and a lot of those people left Lionhead and even the games industry, some of them for years, some of them for good. Lionhead itself was changed by the experience, and most would say that it wasn't for the better. The vision of a small independent studio was now a distant, almost comedic memory. And as we will see, Peter Molyneux himself, and the perception of Molyneux, was changed forever. We have seen nothing but positive about him so far. This is the turning point. We'll get to that though. Before that, we have to look into the monster's eyes and examine Fable itself. For now though, I leave you with the most apt closing line to a famous monologue I can think of. Cue Captain Quint.
Anyway, we delivered the bomb.
Fable is, at its core, an action RPG. Simple and solid combat, rolling around at enemies and all that. And all that stuff works just fine, just as it did in Ocarina of Time or whatever. But it's a deeper game than that. It did promise a lot of freedom after all. As well as all those choices. To do a good deed or a bad deed. Even the Guildmaster at the end of the tutorial doesn't seem to be too bothered about you possibly going on to be an evil bastard. Which is, well, hey-ho. Karma was already a thing in RPGs all the way back to Dungeons & Dragons, and sometimes it was used for exciting grey areas. But this feels a bit more like that old video game classic. Punching a bully? Good! Punching the bullied kid for no reason? Bad! It all appears to be a bit binary. How will being good or being evil actually affect the world in the grand scheme of things? That can be a little questionable. Not that choosing your path isn't fun, and you can certainly be extremely angelic or extremely, evilly evil, but it's perhaps not quite what was promised. Just looking at the game though, in 2016, it's perhaps not wise to get too hung up on those promises. We will get to them. Fable is a very good action RPG with a lot of neat stuff attached. The thing that strikes me a lot about the game is the personality of it, how cities actually do feel lived in and occupied by people. Even the smallest of NPCs actually feels like a proper person and everything. It's in direct contrast to something like Elder Scrolls that's never gotten past its reputation for being robotic and stilted. I also really dig games where your reputation does matter and things that you do get commented on, and Fable does that very well indeed. I seem to have acquired the nickname of Chicken Chaser just through following traditional Zelda-esque tropes and attacking chickens whenever I see them. I never had to even seek it out at all.
Aww, Chicken Chaser, look at the chicken.
In fact, just talking about the comments and the like does the world of Fable injustice. This game's world is beautifully realised and it actually does feel like you have an effect on it. People won't just call you a hero, they'll actually follow you around. They'll get haircuts and clothes just like yours. Or they'll run away in fear. And again, as in Black and White, I appreciate that Lionhead don't do slider bars. How you look, your physique and what have you, depends on how you play and how well you do. Use swords and you'll become big and strong, be stealthy and you'll be wiry in life, and so on. It's things like this that are appreciated, and really separate the game from, again, something like Elder Scrolls. As much as I do like Elder Scrolls, it seems like you're purely in search of a honorific title at times, and aside from that, it's almost as if you don't exist. There's almost too much freedom. This is controlled, but naturally so. And there's so much fun stuff to seek out everywhere, including lots of cool minigames like frickin' coin golf. I could do stuff like this for hours. I appreciate that this isn't a full review, and I'm not going to do the whole thing justice in all this time, but Fable does what it does very well. If you could call this a first impression, almost, then it's a very good one indeed. There's another thing that Fable has that wasn't all that common. A certain Britishness about it. Plenty of quirks here and there, a definite sense of humour and playfulness. For all the horrors that happened in its development, you don't really notice it in the main game. And it is just, in the end, quite a lot of fun to play. Breezing through the main quest might be a slog, but as with any game like this, the fun comes in just immersing yourself in the town, looking into the side quests, and relaxing into the experience. Little things here and there like proper merchant systems, buying up houses or courting folk make it even easier to do that. And it is just quite solid mechanically. It's fun to have a fight, it's fun to cast spells, it's fun to just travel the world. It's a very good action RPG indeed, and the reviews were excellent. So, why were people so angry? Well, there's one answer for that. Something to do with a guy who is by now on the verge of finally going completely bald. Whenever Fable gets brought up, Molyneux's promises must be mentioned. Because who boy did they cause controversy. As he'd done for most other games, he'd been in the press a lot and said a bunch of high profile shit, getting het up about the game, all emotional and stuff. And saying stuff that, well, didn't quite end up happening. There were three things in particular. The first was that Fable would have multiplayer, which it didn't.
The other thing I should say is, we can't really demonstrate it here, Fable can be played up to 4-player multiplayer cooperatively. All you do is you take your joypad, plug it in there, no setup screens, you're in the world.
Will you be able to show it today, or is it just
too
buggy?
The second was that you could get married in Fable, which you could, and have children, which you couldn't.
And definitely in this game, you can chat up women, you can even get married, and you can have children. I won't go into the details of how you do that.
Okay.
The third was that you could plant an acorn and over the course of the game, that acorn would grow into a tree. Which it didn't and you couldn't. Which one do you think caused the biggest kerfuffle? That bloody acorn. It is kind of odd. The two other things seem like pretty important features and mechanics that didn't make it or ever had a chance to. It's known that Molyneux announcing multiplayer, for example, wasn't known by Lionhead at all when it happened, and apparently caused a huge panic. This is one of the first visible examples of a rather shitty Molyneux practice. He didn't have a script or a filter. He could blab things, major things that weren't necessarily a part of the plan, that basically just came from his head, and all of a sudden that's out worldwide. Not good for already very stressed people. Usually Peter could be dialed back, of course, but the damage was already done. And in the wake of Fable's release, people focused on that acorn. Fans of the game in fact raised a massive stink about it, saying that in general Fable was not anywhere near the immersive open world experience it was supposed to be, and more like a souped up action RPG with some cute tricks and morality. The acorn was the symbol of that, even if it was more like a cute feature than something actually important, like the other two would have been. Let alone the less mentioned fact that this open world RPG was a game where you could be exactly the person you wanted to be, good or evil, but not male or female. The general point is, Peter Molyneux's hype actually damaged Fable by making it out to be something it wasn't fully going to be, as opposed to the really good game that it actually was. The result of this was that Peter Molyneux ended up delivering a personal apology on Fable's forums, filled with statements that would become familiar during just about every Lionhead game's post-mortem. Talking about how excited he gets, using his not great coding knowledge to explain reasons why X feature isn't in the game, and saying that perhaps he shouldn't talk about these things as much, essentially that he should become more conventional instead of excitedly talking about games that are years away, still embryonic. It all appears heartfelt, but is it genuine? Is Molyneux trying to present himself as someone outside of the system to make up for a game's shortcomings? Molyneux, outside the system, of all people? Is all that just a poor attempt at technobabble to obfuscate other issues? It almost reads sometimes as if he is, in part, trying to make people feel bad for having such a go at him. This wasn't the first time that Molyneux had promised a little too much, and it sure as hell wouldn't be the last, but this was one of the first major high-profile examples. And so, despite everything, even the successful and really good game that Lionhead had created, Fable caused a significant dent in the reputation of Peter Molyneux. And honestly, I'm not sure if he ever truly recovered from it. That acorn had a lot to frickin' answer for.
We had this simulation and kids get up and they go to school and they go back. To my horror, I went into testing, this is about a year ago, and I went into testing, I looked at someone's screen, and they were all dead.
However, regardless of anything that Molyneux had said, the promises he'd made that weren't delivered on, the long development and brutal crunch, one thing was certain. Fable was, deservedly, a huge hit. And so was 2005's expanded edition, Fable The Lost Chapters. It was the fastest selling game in the history of the Xbox at that point, won numerous awards, and went on to sell 3 million copies worldwide. The only franchise that was more important than Fable to Microsoft was Halo. The monster had done good, and it was here to stay. In 2005, Lionhead could count as many as 300 people among their numbers. And despite the success, Lionhead were in a troubling position because they were just too big. The studio was becoming impossible to manage, and thanks to a humongous wage bill, impossible to profit from. The success of Fable was offset greatly by the relative failures of Black and White 2 and the movies, or the losses generated through cancelled projects. Molyneux himself is in an awkward position again, unable to maintain control of a ship in heavy waters. He wasn't any good at this whole management thing. The studio was, bluntly put, not making enough money to sustain itself. It had spread itself way, way too thin. The main cause of all this mess happened in 2001, when Lionhead tried to float on the stock market. They'd been told by experts that doing so could make their company worth a ton of cash, almost $500 million in fact. With big pound signs in their eyes, Molyneux, Webley and the rest of the management set out to do it. Preparations for flotation included buying up Big Blue Box and Intrepid, and expanding the studio. This was also when the one game at a time idea was totally abandoned, as it was important to have a lot of potentially successful properties in the pipeline, expanding the studio more. But no worries, because the flotation would cover it. It all looked good. Everything was ready. And then 9/11 happened. The stock market in general went to hell, and floating the company would have at that point been madness. The plans to float bit the dust. But all the agreements were still in place, and suddenly that money that was going to cover them wasn't going to be there. From that point on, Lionhead had to rely on venture capitalist investment, and frankly, they struggled from that point on. With only one success out of the next three games following on from that, and their resources drained for an expansion that no longer had a purpose, it became clear eventually that they were not going to recover from this blow without taking drastic action. The solution? Well, it's almost a case of history repeating. The independent studio dream was over, and it was time to either make massive cuts, which Molyneux was not prepared to do, at least not himself, or sell up. The two interested parties were Ubisoft and Microsoft. The former world paints an odd future, where we'd have likely seen Fable sequels on all next-gen platforms, while Microsoft's interest was based utterly in securing a prized product for the Xbox line alone. This wasn't all that similar to Bullfrog aside from the sale itself. Whereas Bullfrog were the hottest property on the market and could sell to anybody, for Lionhead, securing a deal was about securing the company's future. The way things were, they could have gone under in spectacular fashion. In the end, Microsoft won the day, meaning that Fable and all other Lionhead products would be Xbox and Xbox 360 exclusive. It is not known exactly how much Microsoft paid for Lionhead, but it is known to be a lot less than the $375 million they'd paid for Rare a couple of years previous. Apparently, it was a bargain. Fable, the monster, had almost killed Lionhead, and at the same time, it ended up saving Lionhead. And so Lionhead's independent years came to an end. In the third part of this trilogy, we will look at the Microsoft years. Or alternatively, the Fable years. And as for Peter Molyneux, well, the worst is yet to come. Many thanks for watching the second part of The Rise and Fall of Peter Molyneux. If you liked this video, then please consider subscribing. You can also follow me on my social media, Facebook, Twitter, and also support me on Patreon. Righto, I'm just coming off a cold, so this should be good. Martin Pataki, Taylor Armand, Mark Johnston, Twisted Squote, Jamie Hampshire, Andre Russell, Lee Norris, Graven Blackpool. Thank you so much for awesome support so far. And of course, there's more. There's Tim Lintz, Robert Kelly, Thomas Daniels, Greg Olson, Paul Street, Stuart Ashen, Lee Harris, Tiago Pereira dos Santos Silva dos Santos Silva, James Idd, Mike Siegler, Mike Spooner, Edge Reader, Russell Hugo, Ken Barraclough, Mark Johnson, Gerard Morris, Scott Coulter, Paolo Leary, Graham Kamak, Scott Mitten, Nicole Ketchum, Mark Brooks, Ninth Demon, Peter Sidorn, Ludwig Holmstrom, John Azil, Kit Leary, El O'Brien, Dave Parkinson, Novel, and Olaf Holbein. Phew, gets bigger every time, which is good. Thank you all so much for your fantastic support. I love you all. I shall be back, hopefully in a week, 2 weeks' time, with the third part of this epic Peter Molyneux what was a trilogy and is now probably going to be a saga, when we'll be looking at the rest of Lionhead. But until then, it is time as ever to say, wherever you are and whoever you be, have a good one, take care, and I'll see you next time. Bye for now.